Anyway, today I'm here to talk about the latest news from MongooseIM team. At the beginning, few words about me. I am, most of all, happy husband and father to 3 years old daughter. I'm senior developer at Erlang Solutions with more than 5 years experience, and I'm MongooseIM tech lead doing MongooseIM. All right.
Hello, is it better? Okay. As I was saying, I'm MongooseIM tech lead, responsible for MongooseIM development. Also, I am XSF member. XSF is XMPP Standard Foundation. And I am amateur runner. 2 half marathons passed me, and I am preparing to marathon. All right, get back to the talk. Today I'm going to talk a bit about MongooseIM past releases. These are 2.0.0 and 2.0.1. Also, I will talk about 2.1.0, which is upcoming release. We hope to release beta 2 next weeks. Also, I will tell about 3 other things we built inside the MongooseIM team, and I think this will be interesting. Starting with Mongoose, we can summarize MongooseIM 2.0 with this phrase: MongooseIM Platform 2.0, higher value and lower friction. While working on MongooseIM 2.0 version, we get our product owner, which helped us pivot a bit, because before that we were focused only on the MongooseIM server written in Erlang, implementing XMPP protocol. But with our product owner Nico, we decided to do more than just XMPP server. We started contributing to XMPP libraries just to improve them, improve the features there, which are implemented by the libraries, but also to provide feature parity between the XMPP libraries for Android and iOS and MongooseIM. On top of these libraries, we built sample applications. They are called Mongoosta iOS and Mongoosta Android. They are already open sourced, but we are not allowed about it yet, because we need to do some more polishing to make them better and easier to use. Also, as the MongooseIM platform, we contribute plugin to Wombat OAM. This is tool to use to monitoring Erlang nodes, and can be used to work with MongooseIM as well. We also build Tide, our continuous integration platform, and also to extend feature and functionality of MongooseIM, we created MongooseIM Push and MongooseIM Ice, which I will talk about later. The most important things added in MongooseIM 2.0 are REST APIs. We have 2 kind of REST APIs. One is for backend services. Before that, integrating MongooseIM with other components in your system wasn't very convenient. We had the MongooseIM CTL tool, but this was like a script running on the node where MongooseIM was running. But in release 2.0, we added REST API for other backend services, so that it is really easy now to integrate MongooseIM with other components in our system. All the APIs are described in Swagger specification and are available in our documentation on Read the Docs. Here there are links pointing to specific versions and the specification which are implemented in these versions. The other REST API we added in 2.0 is specifically for client connections. This API implements some basic XMPP functionalities, but over REST API with JSON. So this is most for client developers loving REST calls and JSON. And this makes application prototyping easier and faster, as a lot of people knows REST and JSON. So far, the XMPP functionalities exposed over the REST API are basically sending and reading one-to-one messages, and also group chat functionalities. So clients can create their own group chats, can send messages in group chats, and get the message archive inside a group chat. In version 2.0.1, we added SSE. This stands for server sent events. In general, this is very simple HTTP call to the server, and you have the connection open so that the server can push events to you. The protocol is very simple and well defined, so all the events are structured and easy to interpret. This REST API is also covered in Swagger specification, and these links are pointing to relevant versions of these specifications. Other important thing we added in 2.0 is Mooklight. This is, we can say, a subset and presence-less version of the original MOOC as described in XEP 004.5. The original MOOC is not well designed and well suited for mobile devices, where you can lose connectivity very often. And this was the principle while working on Mooklight. This is presence-less, that's why you don't have to be online to get messages from the room. You can get into a tube or a elevator, and the messages sent in this time will be delivered to you later when you reconnect. The full specification is available in our documentation, and also last year here at EUC there was talk by my colleague Ludwig specifically about Mooklight technicalities and scalability with Mooklight. All right, next thing we actually restored in MongooseIM is PubSub. When we started MongooseIM product, we removed this because we find it very inefficient and very complex, but over the years we learned that this is one of the features we miss, and a lot of applications can use PubSub pattern to implement not chat-related things. And also PubSub is a foundation for some other extensions to the XMPP protocol. For example, personal eventing protocol, microblogging over XMPP, and push notifications. They are all based on PubSub in some ways. That's why we decided to basically recreate PubSub in MongooseIM. And now comes 2.0.1 with summary like more stability for app developers. This doesn't mean MongooseIM 2.0 was unstable. It just means that we released 2.0 and listened to the market and extended, improved it in the way it was most suitable for people using MongooseIM. And in 2.0.1, we added features like HTTP file upload. This is another XMPP extension, which basically gives you a URL to which you can post your file, and a GET URL from which you or other people with which you share the link can download the file. Uploading and downloading is done out of XMPP with simple HTTP post and GET requests. Right now, Mongoose is integrated with Amazon S3 storage. More backends will probably be added later. As I already said, we added SSE, server sent events for REST clients, in 2.0.1. And also we did a lot of technical improvements. One of them are completely new Cassandra backend for message archive management. Also simplified message archive management configuration. Previously, you had to start from 2 to 5 different modules to get MAM working. With the simplified version, you can just start one module and every other dependent module will be started based on the config you pass to the one. Also, thanks to work with one of our customers, we could optimize the original MOOC implementation. The original MOOC implementation is heavily based on Erlang processes. Every room is represented by a single process. And this may cost a lot of memory, especially when you create a lot of rooms. That's why we introduced two levels of optimization. First one is simple Erlang process hibernation. It works like if there is no communication in given room for some configured time, the process goes into hibernation and the memory consumed by this process is reduced. Later, after some time from the hibernation, if there is still no events in the room, this process can go into deep hibernation, and this is basically about stopping the process completely and dumping the state into a database. And so it later can be restarted when an event occurs. This deep hibernation is not for every MOOC type, because with the original MOOC, you can have many different configurations of the rooms, and the deep hibernation works only for invite-only rooms and when the only online participant is the room owner. Only then the room can go into deep hibernation. Also, we extended our MOOC light by adding ODBC backend. Previously, only Minijia was used to store all the MOOC light data. Now we can do this with ODBC, MySQL or Postgres as well. And now let's go to MongooseIM 2.1.0. We can describe it like this. What happens when you give your team freedom? For 2.1 release, we basically set up a very generic roadmap, kind of direction in which we would like to go. And we just let the team have fun and implement what they wanted so that they enjoy it and have as much fun as they could. And in the end, MongooseIM 2.1.0 Beta 1, which was released in April, contains push notification feature. This is another XMPP extension, very generic pattern, which allows mobile clients to enable push notifications. This is implemented partially in MongooseIM, partially in standalone component. This is the MongooseIM push, which I will talk about later as well. Also, we integrated MongooseIM with Amazon SNS queues. This is basically to push some system events like user connected, user disconnected, message was sent from this user to that user, or a group chat with in this room was posted to some Amazon SNS queues for further processing. For example, one can use this to apply some business logic based on these events. Also, we added full text search to our message archive management in React KV backend and MySQL Postgres. Only the MySQL Postgres is based on the full text search provided by MySQL or Postgres, which may not be very scalable when you have a lot of messages in the archive. Instead, React KV is based on the React search powered by Apache Solr, and this is more scalable. So for big data sets, I suggest using React KV and the full text search provided by it. Other important things we added in 2.1.0 is XMPP pipelining. Without this, especially the initiation part of the connection would require a lot of round trips. A client had to send one stanza, wait for the response, send another stanza, wait for another response. And the responses are mostly saying the client, okay, proceed. With the pipelining, the client can batch all the stanzas in one TCP packet, send it to the server, and in the end, it will get authenticated stream. And this is far way faster, especially when we are on a very poor network, when the latency is significant. The other thing we added in 2.1.0 is Erlang distribution over TLS. So now the whole cluster can run over encrypted network, not only the plain connection, the default one, but you can configure MongooseIM cluster to have encrypted connection between the nodes. It is useful for some installations. All right, that would be all about news regarding MongooseIM, the server specifically. And now I'd like to introduce our tool, which we are very proud of. It is continuous load testing. In the MongooseIM team, we cared about quality from the very beginning. Until we introduced Tide, we were utilizing the following tools. We used Travis CI to run all our functional tests. On Travis, we have 8 different jobs where we test MongooseIM with different Erlang OTP versions and also with different configurations, just to be sure that MongooseIM works correctly with all the backends we support. Every job takes from 32 to 38 minutes. And also, we had a dedicated job for dialyzer only. My opinion is that if you don't have dialyzer in your CI, sooner or later, your specs will not be correct. And this happened to us twice already. First, when we introduced specs, function specs to our code base, we didn't have dialyzer in the CI. So soon, the specs stopped being corrected and the dialyzer started failing. But since it wasn't in the CI, we didn't know about it. So we decided to add it to the CI process, and we do it for every library we use in MongooseIM. Also, we care about the code coverage, and right now the coverage is over 70%. And all the results are uploaded to coverals.io. And also, so far we kept an eye on code style, and to keep an eye on the code style, we used the LVCI. This is a tool provided by Inaka, which applies a lot of code style rules to the pull request you send on GitHub and complains about every new line which is not following the rules. This is, I find it very useful when it comes to improving the code and the style we want to have. But this was not enough for us. I mean, all the functional tests and other are important. It gives us the confidence that our work is correct and with good quality. But we lacked continuous performance monitoring. That's why we created Tide. This is a simple orchestration platform, which is integrated with GitHub pull request. So every time there is a pull request to the master branch, a load test is started so that we can see if the performance is better or worse, or at least stays the same. And the Tide utilizes Docker Swarm, so all the machines, MongooseIM nodes and Amog nodes, the load generator tool, are started on Docker. Tide cares about setting and cleaning the infrastructure before and after the test. It runs the load test and collects the metrics, which are then archived and can be accessed later to analyze the performance. This is a simple workflow, how this looks. So when there is a pull request on GitHub, a job on Travis just started. One of the jobs is building the Docker image and uploads it to Docker Hub. Then Docker notifies Tide, and then Tide downloads this image and starts MongooseIM cluster with this new image. Later it starts Amok nodes. Amok is a very simple tool to run the load tests and run the scenario we decided to run. And the load test starts. After that, as I said, metrics are collected and they are available to analyze later. Actually, I can show how this looks. This is a simple, the basic dashboard, publicly available, so anyone can go to this site and see what load tests were run, what was the result. We can even go to one of the load tests I ran before the conference. Here we can see some details when it was started, how many users was run in this load test, the number of nodes, MongooseIM nodes used in this load test, number of Amok nodes. And also we have links to different configuration files used in this load test. This particular load test was about checking the performance of the whole cluster when the connection between them is encrypted. And we have a metrics button, which gives us basically the snapshot of all the metrics collected during the load test. We can see that the most interesting metric for us at this moment is time to delivery of a message, as seen by the client from the Amok site. And with the Erlang distribution over TLS, we can see that the maximum time to delivery was a little bit over 30 milliseconds. So I would say it's not that high. And if we compare this with a load test with the same number of users, but without TLS between nodes, we can see that it's only about 10 milliseconds slower than with encryption enabled. Oh, I can show a bit more regarding this tool. Additionally to the automatically started pull request based on GitHub load test based on GitHub pull request, we can use this platform to start a manual load test where we can specify number of users which should be spawned in this load test, how long the load test should run. We can define the arrival rate, how fast new users should be created. We can choose MongooseIM image and define different parameters of the load test and hit the submit button, and the load test will be queued and executed later. We already used this tool to prove that, for example, the XMPP pipelining optimizes the connection time significantly. As you can see, without pipelining, it's the top graph. The reconnection takes around almost 200 milliseconds, but with pipelining, reconnection takes below 50 milliseconds. So this is huge difference and improves the user experience significantly. All right, that would be all about the continuous load testing platform. There are two other things added to MongooseIM platform. The first one is MongooseIM push. This is a standalone component written in Elixir. It's open source. Everyone can use it, not necessarily with MongooseIM, but if there is a need to talk with APNS or FCM, Mongoose Push provides simple REST API, which can be called, and push notifications will be delivered to your devices, to Android or iOS, depending what you need. And this tool, this component is used to enable push notifications in MongooseIM. It may look quite complicated because the XMPP extension describing push notifications is very generic, but we could simplify this by merging these two blue boxes. We described it like this just to show that you can have the push notifications on different MongooseIM or XMPP server than the one handling your user connections, but in most cases these two components can be merged and run on the same cluster. And here is a workflow, what a client should do in order to enable push notifications as described in the XEP and with the Mongoose Push component. Also here is a link to a tutorial describing in more details how to use Mongoose Push, how to configure it with MongooseIM and have notifications delivered to the mobile devices. And the last component I would like to introduce is MongooseIM Eyes. Its code name is Fennec. This is the little animal here. This is basically a stun and turn server written in Elixir, as any new component we add to MongooseIM platform. It is also standalone, can be used with or without MongooseIM, depending on your needs. And the stun turn server is basically used to set up a peer-to-peer connection between clients. Also, it can be used as a relay server if the peer-to-peer connectivity is not possible because of some strange NAT configurations and firewall settings. You can use MongooseEyes to relay the traffic to the other site. We also have a simple tutorial on our MongooseIM read the docs documentation describing how to configure it, how to run it, and how to have video streamed from a Raspberry Pi to your mobile phone. And that's it. As usual, I was speeding with my presentation. Thank you.
How have you found using React Search
as a product? It has its advantages and disadvantages. If it is about the full text search, it is far more better than what we have in MySQL or Postgres. If it is about regular access to the archive, MySQL and Postgres are more efficient, at least in the load tests we run. Probably when we run a load test with several millions of messages, then React could behave better than just MySQL or Postgres, but we didn't run such big load tests yet. We have a MongooseIM product page at Erlang Solutions website, and all these customers using MongooseIM are listed there. There is several big companies using MongooseIM to provide chat functionality to their products. I'm not sure which I may talk about right now, which I don't. I'd like to tell about every customer we work with, but some of them don't want to be publicized. If you go to Erlang Solutions page and the MongooseIM product page, we will find those companies who want to share this knowledge. because these components are standalone, we don't have Erlang distributed between them. There is a REST API for Mongoose Push or the Stantern protocol for Mongoose Eyes. Actually, Mongoose Eyes doesn't talk with Mongoose IM, because Mongoose Eyes is used by the client to basically get to know about your public interfaces and to share. And then when you have the public interfaces from Mongoose Eyes, you can use Mongoose IM and Jingle extension to signal your endpoints to the other user and then try to set up the peer-to-peer connection. So there is no direct communication between Mongoose IM, the server, and Mongoose IM Eyes. On GitHub, the LVCI is designed to work with GitHub only for new code. But we now are in the process of improving the whole code base. So every week, one of the developers is trying to improve different part of the code base, running LVs locally and fixing all the issues. A lot of. Actually, you can find all the pull requests in Mongoose IM fixing Elvis issues. So you will know what amount of lines it took to improve the coding style. Well, that's fine. Thank you.